Thank you for being here. Like Melissa, I'm going to try to share a little bit about my story, what I do, and what I've learned so far in my career, which, you know, it's been surprising and interesting and fun. So when I was a little kid growing up in India, I would dream about what I want to be. I'm sure you all did too, right? And I dreamed about growing up and becoming a quantum physicist. No, I didn't. I really didn't. I had no clue what that was, of course, right? But, you know, I did like science, you know? From a very young age, I loved science. Who here loves science? Yeah, we're all science people here. Yeah, yay. Let's see if this way to work. But what is science? What do you guys think of when you say science? What do you love? Experiments, I heard somewhere. Really hard to see you guys, but yeah. Experiments, yes. What else? Biology. Is that what you meant? Yeah, biology, that's science. That, as far as I know, yep. That involves a bit of science. So I hear. Anything else? Space. Oh, I love space. Space is awesome, and space is all about science. Yeah. Other stuff? Science? What do scientists do? Oh my gosh, that's the great word, because that's kind of perfect, and I didn't plant that word there, but that's kind of what I want to talk about today. Yes, discovery. In fact, for me, a scientist to me is kind of like nature's detective, right? We collect clues, and we ask questions, and we try to figure out how the universe works in different ways, and we try to ask the question, what do we know? How do we know? But we also have to ask another question. What do we not know? We often don't necessarily think about what we don't know. Right? We usually try to think about science as what we do know and how to know stuff. But I want to talk today a little bit about what we don't know and why that's really important. In fact, that's a difficult question to answer, right? If I ask you, what don't you know? That's weird, right? If you think about it, how do you know what you don't know? Right? Maybe you don't even know if there is something to not know. You see how this is getting a bit weird? I woke up this morning and asked myself, how many times can I say the word no? And the answer is, I don't know. Yeah, the point I'm trying to get to here is that, in fact, what we don't know obviously defines what we do know, of course, as much as what we actually study and can and write down very clearly. Sure, that tells us the sum total of what we call science. But the boundaries of that are really about what we don't know. And pushing on the boundary is all about asking and figuring out, how do we know what we don't know? For science and in nature, it's nature itself that tells us what we don't know. That's how we find out what we don't know. So let me give you an interesting example. Back in the 1600s, there was a famous astronomer, you may have heard of him, Kepler. Who has heard of Johannes Kepler? Yeah, quite famous. What did he do? You guys have heard of him, right? Why is he famous? Anybody remember? Astronomer, he was studying how the planets were moving. You guys, is that what you're thinking? Well, yeah. In fact, actually, you're right. Kepler designed a telescope. So his sort of almost compatriot Galileo was the first one, right, who used a telescope famously. But Kepler also designed a telescope. He was studying how all the planets orbited the sun, and that was kind of a new idea. That wait. There's the sun in the center and the planets are orbiting, right? Because before that, for 2,000 years, we all believe that the Earth is not moving. And how do we know that the Earth is moving? We don't feel it, right? So it's a pretty, you know, normal thing to believe that the Earth is the center and everything else is moving. But this new idea was the sun is in the center, the planets are orbiting, and Kepler was trying to figure out something about the details of that. And in fact, he was specifically studying very carefully the orbit of Mars. Right? And he noticed something weird. You know, he had made these calculations of these orbits, and he found that it didn't quite match the observation. meaning that if you actually try to predict exactly where Mars is in the orbit, it's just a little bit off. And when I say little bit, I really mean a little bit. Less than even 1 degree. Right? Just a tiny bit. Tiny bit. What we don't know, right? A little bit we don't know. But Kepler didn't ignore it. You know how he figured it out? Anybody remember? This is what actually made him famous, right? Well, we don't think about it really about in that particular way. We know that he did something cool about orbits, right? But what's amazing is that this little bit less than 1 degree of discrepancy, of what he did not understand, what he did not know, got him to an amazing idea. And we had got it wrong. We didn't know, in fact, what was happening with the planet. The orbits were, he had assumed, were perfect circles around the sun. And that's not true. Today we know that they are more like ellipses, as shown here. Now, this is, of course, very exaggerated. The orbits of the planets are almost circular, but they're not quite. That's why that 1 degree off. So that little bit of what he did not quite figure out, the little error, led him to this huge new discovery, and that led to Newton figuring out the orbits and what we know about the force of gravity. So big, right? Big. And really confirmed in the end that, nope, we are not the center of the universe on Earth. So that's kind of a good lesson to learn, I guess. And this is not the only example. I want to tell you one more really cool, interesting example, and this has to do with another planet, and that is Mercury. So Mercury, as you know, is the closest planet to the sun. Yep. So it feels the gravity of the sun the most, right? That because it's close, that's how it works. But if you look very, very closely again, very carefully, you can't ever be not precise, right, in science. Look very carefully at these orbits of Mercury. As it orbits, over hundreds of years, it slowly swings around, right, as you see plotted here. So it doesn't just orbit like this. The entire orbit itself is orbiting, right? It's an orbit of an orbit, which is what we call precession, over many, many hundreds of years. And again, you can use Newton's beautiful theory of gravity to predict and calculate exactly how fast Mercury will orbit. All the planets do this, but with Mercury, it's the clearest because it feels the sun's gravity the most. Yeah. So people calculated this and found that, oh, there's a problem. Again, what's the problem? Well, it's almost great, but there's a little 7% error. Doesn't work. Oh, we don't understand it. Again, what don't we know? What's going on that we're missing? And for many years, people thought, oh, it's probably some nearby asteroid, right, that's causing problems, or maybe there's a hidden planet. That would have been cool, right? Some dark planet that's impacting Mercury. But nobody quite could explain it until a whole new idea came about thanks to another very famous scientist. Anybody know who I'm talking about? Who figured it out? You may have heard of this guy. Einstein? Some guy I heard about, right? That guy. So, no, what he came up with was a whole new idea about how gravity works. And he realized, oh, there's no real force. What's happening is that the sun and all massive, huge objects like the stars and the planets, in fact, even you and I, anything that has mass, what we do is we fold the space around us, right? We're like, you know, sort of like how if you put a bowling ball in on an elastic sheet and you get a big, big dip, a valley. Well, the sun is a gigantic bowling ball, like huge. It's causing this huge valley in the rubber sheet of space, and that's why Mercury and all the planets are trapped in that valley. So that's essentially this whole new way of thinking about how things move, how the planets move, and when you use that picture, the discrepancy disappears. So again, the teeny, teeny little bit of what we didn't know drove a whole new idea and a whole new understanding of the universe. So that's kind of what I mean by the fact that these kinds of edges of knowledge are really, really important. And in fact, almost all science is driven by this. And that's a good thing. So always try to know, understand what you know, but also make sure you have some idea of what you don't know, right? That'll tell you where you want to know and what you want to discover in the future. And who knows, maybe you'll figure out some amazing new idea, right, from that edge. But I also want to tell you about something else that when I started doing quantum physics, I found out, right? Again, something new I didn't know. And that has to do with not knowing and on a whole new level. That's what quantum physics is all about, by the way. You know, quantum physics is the ultimate theory of not knowing anything, really. And you may have heard it's a weird theory. It really is. In the theory of quantum physics, what's completely different is that the not knowing is built into the theory, right? Meaning it tells you that the reason you don't know something is not just because you haven't measured it or your theory is wrong or there's some precision problem. The theory tells you that there could be all those problems, but in addition to that, even if you tried your best and you had the perfect theory and you had all possible knowledge about your system, you cannot know everything about a particular, like a quantum particle, like an electron or a proton or an atom. If you want to know everything about that object, you can't. Nature tells us it's not knowable. So not knowing is absolutely as important as knowing in quantum physics. That's what's really amazing about this theory, which makes it very confusing, of course. So I like to think about this nice, you know, balancing act. This is a nice picture from an instructor at the University of Pittsburgh. You can think of, if you, for example, want to know exactly where an object is, it's in its precise position, the more you try to pin that down, the less you know about its momentum, which is about how fast it's going or which direction it's moving. And the more you know about its speed and its direction, the less you know about where it is. Kind of like a crazy GPS, right? That never quite works perfectly. But this is fundamentally how things are. The theory itself builds that in. So that's really interesting, right? And kind of weird, as I said. But for me, this was kind of like, that's something we now learn is we were introduced to this by this guy named Heisenberg. You might have heard of, not the guy from Breaking Bad. This is the famous German physicist Heisenberg, and this is called the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. So indeterminacy here means uncertainty. The more uncertainty you have in one thing, the less on the other, and so on. So it's this balancing act. There's no such thing as zero uncertainty, zero not knowing. That does not exist, so we might as well embrace it, right? And for me personally, I could relate to this whole idea, to be honest. Because when I started studying physics and I started taking graduate courses and then went on further in my career, this is mostly how my classes used to look like. There's still not a whole lot of women in physics classes. How many here take physics? Oh my gosh, yes, good, excellent. Keep taking those classes. I think your classes will look a lot different than mine. I was often the only person in the room, a female in the room. And then when I went to conferences, often there weren't many women who were either speaking or participating in the conference. And I also realized over time that, you know, when I was in these kinds of physics discussions or trying to do research in the lab or whatever, you know, when the interactions were kind of interesting. So, you know, if I was doing physics and people were interacting with me about physics and seeing me as a physicist, somehow they kind of ignored the fact that I'm a female, right? But if they were the same people when they were interacting with me socially maybe or as a female, they would kind of see me less as a physicist, right? So when I was more precisely a physicist, I was less precisely a female. And when I was more precisely a female, yep. It's quantum physics. I was experiencing the uncertainty principle, obviously. So I'm like, interesting. So what am I? Maybe there is some inherent uncertainty in me too, right? That's what I was wondering. But then I realized something else. As I did more about quantum physics and I really started exploring this area called quantum information, meaning how do you take these laws, these weird laws of quantum physics, and do something useful with them? I realized something amazing. This whole thing around uncertainty, not knowing, is extremely powerful. For example, if you can now build these systems using lasers and you know, different sorts of well-established technologies around how you control the polarization of lasers and so on, to do interesting kinds of communication. So not knowing, you might think, is a bad thing. How do you control something if you don't know it perfectly? Right? Turns out, if you flip it on its head, you can say, oh, if you don't know something, another way to think about not knowing is erasing information. And sometimes that is yet another way of thinking about it is hiding information. So if you have some kind of a situation where you're trying to communicate, but you want to hide information from a third party, you know, security kinds of applications, uncertainty actually works in your favor, because that third person also will face this uncertainty when they try to listen in. Turns out, because of that uncertainty, you will sort of be able to know that here's this third person is trying to listen in. So if you work all of these laws exactly right, you can make uncertainty work for you. And in fact, we now know this kind of an encryption protocol, which is called quantum key distribution, is the only known, perfectly secure, unconditionally secure way of communication that we know of today. And it's not like, you know, maybe in 10 years we'll build a super fast computer and somehow that'll crack it. No, in order to crack this kind of encryption, you have to break the laws of physics. You have to actually change nature. It's like, you know, it's like, for example, saying, let's just turn off gravity in this room. You can't do that, no matter how big, how good your computer is, right? So this is what it means. It's powerful. Not knowing and uncertainty is a really powerful thing. And why stop with one particle being uncertain or not? We can actually make collections of particles that talk to each other. This is a picture showing lasers passing through this crystal, and then you get these beams of light from that crystal. If you tune everything just right, those beams of light consist of particles of light, photons. And the photons are connected to each other. They're sort of locked together in this handshake, even if you send them to opposite sides of the universe. And that's something called entanglement. And so they're always, in a sense, connected, but they also have this uncertainty. And if you can use that connection combined with uncertainty, you can do even more powerful things, such as teleportation. So you might think, okay, this is sounding kind of weird in sci-fi. Actually, people do this in the lab these days. And why do it just with two particles? Let's make huge networks, right? So part of the research that I am involved in now is thinking about building these interesting networks with lots of photons and Alice and Bob and people sharing information and doing security tasks all around the world, if possible. And this is, yes, it seems like, yeah, quite on the edge of science, right? What do we know? What can we use this for? It's not just to build new ways to communicate. It's to find those edges, right? Saying, how far can we push this? And when we finally hit a wall, we'll know, oh, that's what we don't know. We better find a new theory. And then we learn more. So that's what's really exciting about this kind of work. And listen, it's not just all about communication. There's been this huge focus also here at Perimeter Institute. Waterloo is a great hub for this, in focusing on building computers based on uncertainty. How weird, right? A computer that actually harnesses not knowing to do calculations? How weird. But that's what we call quantum computers. And there's lots of progress being made in this direction, which is great. But the truth is we already have a lot of very powerful computers, right? In fact, we have such powerful computers that we're all on the computer all the time. Even our, you know, little mobiles are really powerful. They are actually more powerful than the computers that got us to the moon, right? That's how much computing power we already have. And we're generating all of this data, as you know, right? Big data. You all have heard about big data, right? So part of our new challenge is not just about calculating, but taking data and understanding data. Data mining, if you like. Searching through data. Guess who is very interested in search? Google, right? When you Google everything. So wouldn't it be interesting to have new ways of searching through data? Well, if you're trying to find things on the internet, often it's like looking through this huge haystack and for that one little needle. But what's interesting is maybe you can think about a quantum haystack, right? Where there is definitely a needle buried in there. But again, what you might want to do is rethink how you think even about information. Remember, what does information mean? It means what you know. That's what information means. And what's the flip side of what you know? What you don't know, right? So there's, again, always, every time you hear these words, information, certainty, precision, there's a flip side to it, which is just as powerful in a sense. And in fact, there's this whole new way of doing searches, which is all about saying, well, let's try to increase the likelihood of finding what we do know and decrease the uncertainty. So start thinking in terms of certainty and uncertainty. And there are very interesting new protocols of using what you don't know to find out what you really want to find out. Has anybody been keeping track of how many times I've used the word no? I mean, come on. So maybe there should be like some kind of a list, I guess. But so this is sort of broadly what has been really exciting for me in my sort of career, exploring this very, very interesting, bizarre world of, you know, quantum particles, which I don't even get to see, right, with my own eyes, because you can't see an electron or an atom. But we can dream up all of these interesting questions that we can ask. And almost all those questions now that I ask have to do with knowing, which is certainty, and not knowing, which is uncertainty. And how we can combine that and talk about real power, real, scientific knowledge is not only about being precise. It's about understanding the power of also not knowing. And in fact, that brings me back, I guess, to my own uncertainty principle problem of woman versus physicist. I guess the answer is kind of clear. You know, we don't have to just be one thing or another. Right? That's really what even nature is telling us. There's no such thing as certainty in any real way. So I guess that's my other big lesson I would leave you with, that explore what you know and what you don't know, but also about yourself. Find identities where you can sort of be like these quantum particles. Don't be just one thing. Shapeshift, right? So be a shapeshifter and adapt. And I think that would make you much more able to explore and experience the world and new situations in totally interesting and amazing ways. Thank you.